Good evening, everybody, and this is Emerald Heart Radio. Welcome to another show. This is Dave Ashworth, your host, and my co-host, Alan Cox, is with us. Hi, Alan, are you there?
I'm there, thank you, Dave. I hope our connection stays on. It was a bit ropey before we came on air, so everything crossed, eh? Everything crossed.
Yeah, everything crossed, as usual. Well, you know, we always have a bit of a laugh, don't we, just before things start, and we had three attempts at getting connected, and then Dave came on, and just as he started to run the reel, he disappeared altogether. I lost the sound totally.
You know,
we're in for another laugh, eh?
It always seems to wait until, I must be jinxed, because it's every time I go on air, there seems to be some problem somewhere.
Yeah, we'll have to give you a bit of a decoke, Alan, and get some of those entities out of you that are interfering with the show.
I think you're right. I think you're right there. Yeah. Hasn't it gone quick since last Friday? It only seems 5 minutes ago. You know, that we was doing the show last week.
Yeah. Well, you've had an interesting week, haven't you, with a few clearances?
Yeah, I have, and you know, that's always a good thing that people come to you for help, isn't it? You know, so and I've got one tomorrow, so we will see what happens, won't we?
Yeah. Well, you know, somebody's got to keep batting them back into orbit.
That's right. as long as I'm better than the English cricket team, we're all right.
Well, yeah. Now, I used to see it like that sometimes. You know, you'd go to do a clearance job and there was so many of them coming out of the woodwork. It's like standing there playing baseball and batting them away.
Yeah, well, it's...
So we got a bit of a theme tonight, Alan.
Sorry?
I think you disappeared then when I was talking and then you came again.
right, okay. Well, As I was saying to you earlier, this thing about putting up on the schedule about what we're going to talk about is really weird, because I do forget to put it up. I don't consult you. And then a few hours before we come on air, this thought pops into my mind what to put on. And today it's about moving forward, I suppose, with the Emerald Heart, with our journey, our spiritual journey in life. And I don't know whether that makes any kind of resonance with you, you know, makes sense to talk about.
Well, you know, as you pose the questions, the guides come through, and just before we came on air, I go through a yawning process, which is the tuning in process. I start yawning like mad. My eyes start streaming. And that's always a good sign, because it shows I'm not alone. It's good to have the backup of the guidance here with us as well. Yes, so when you said that to me, the way forward in life, I mean the way forward in life generally, as well as with the Emerald Heart, I think one of the first things you have to acknowledge is that life can be tough. It can be tough down here in the physical world. And I think as soon as you acknowledge that, it starts to make things easier. So you say to yourself, yeah, you know, life is tough. It has its ups and downs. You know, we're down here in Lanzarote at the moment, and earlier in the week I got a text off a cousin, and she said, "Dear cousin, I know I'm the kind of bitch that only gets in touch when I want something, but I really need your help right now."
I think she's honest. And
yeah, she is. She calls a spade, does our Sandra. And you know, her husband had just been diagnosed with cancer, and they thought it had spread everywhere through this place and that place, etc. And he had to go for some more tests this week. And, you know, she said, "Dave, if you can produce a miracle, I really need one now." So, you know, I just tune into the guides and I say, "Well, I don't know what we can do, but let's do our best." And I put his name on a piece of paper proper, and I sent some energy there, and they went and had their test, and the prognosis wasn't good. Down to say, yeah, they're going to operate, it's only in the stomach, they can't find it anywhere else, so, you know, at least he's going to get some treatment. And she just said, thank you. You can feel, you know, the thanks and the energy of the thanks pouring through this little text. And, you know, I sat back and said, you know, guides, if there was any miracles produced, you're the guys that produced it, not me. You know, I just do a little bit of focusing, and I send a little bit here and I send a little bit there, but we never really know what effects we've had. But with life being tough sometimes,
I'm unfortunately, Dave, your connection sounds like a Norman Collier sketch at the moment. That's too nice on the right. Tonight on the trot, though, I've mentioned that, and Dave, our producer, hasn't got a clue what we're talking about.
No.
Something like that.
Something like that, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, it is. So, so
do we know whether the listeners are hearing anything?
I don't know. I don't know. So, I'm sorry, you were saying about the diagnosis. I heard you say that it wasn't good.
Yeah, well, the prognosis wasn't good, but I got this little text from Sandra tonight to say they got the results and the cancer hadn't spread into any other places, and so they're going to start treatment straight away.
Oh, that's good.
So, you know, she was just pouring out her thanks for whatever I'd done, and, you know, we just these vehicles, we just focus the energy, we focus the light of the universe into a situation, and if it's right that person receives that energy for whatever reason, then they receive it. And
that's right.
I don't know whether my input has any relevance or not. You know, when we're doing clearance work and things like that, we go in there, we find the stuff, we move it out, and we know we've done the job.
Yeah.
But when it comes to things like, you know, the candles, I just hand it upstairs. I say, okay, here's the door. I'll open it for you, but do what you can for these people. You know, they're just people. They need the help of the universe every now and again, and that's all there is to it.
You see, and you know, with the saying about moving forward, this moving forward in life can also see. You think of people think of moving forward as doing things in life, being positive, doing things you haven't done before. But moving forward in life can also be fighting a terrible illness or disease like cancer. Or it can even be moving forward into the next stage of our existence, into moving into spirit.
Are you still there, Alan?
I am, yeah. Can you hear me?
Yeah, did you mean moving into spirit as in leaving this earth plane and moving into spirit in that aspect?
Yeah, this is true.
I heard an interesting thing once. I went to a wedding many, many years ago, maybe 30 years ago, and the minister said something really interesting. He was talking about one thing and another. In fact, it wasn't a wedding, it was a funeral. Shows how long ago it was. And he said, think about life like this. Imagine a woman is bearing twins. She has twins in the womb. And one of those twins is suddenly born into this world. And the other twin thinks, where's he gone? You know, where's she gone? All of a sudden, I'm on my own. It's kind of a form of death. It's a change of state. So, you know, two twins enter into this world. So one shoots through the birth canal and arrives here, and whoopee, we all celebrate. And a few minutes later, the next one comes. But in that moment between those two points, what's the awareness of one of those twins when the other one suddenly isn't there anymore? But of course, actually, within a few minutes, they're reunited.
Actually, the reason why I'm smiling to myself, there's many years ago, somebody sent me this video of two twins, you know, twins in the womb, and the music was like the final countdown, and the one was pointing at the other one, kept on singing the final countdown, and the other one says to the other baby, just wait until we get out of here. I've got it somewhere on my other old computer. I have to get it dug out. I think it's absolutely brilliant. Were you talking about that?
Yeah, it is. Well, you know, it's always just a process of changing state. And it's the fear of separation which makes the death side of it so difficult for us. And of course, our emotional attachments will be human beings. So,
Dave's just written to me saying he now knows what song to pick for the break, the final countdown. All right.
Yes, so coming back to the theme, the way forward in life. The way forward in life is that I think John Lennon kind of summed it up, and I can't remember his exact words, but it was along the lines of, life is what happens to you when you're making plans for other things.
Yes.
So the process of moving forward in life is always to have some kind of a plan. But it's good to have it as a loose plan that can change at any moment in time. You know, we were talking today about a particular person who's been desperate to change her job. And each year she comes up with an image, what she wants to do, but never really moves into it. And so before you know it, many years can go past and you haven't actually changed anything on the life path. And I was writing something just recently about questions you ask yourself when you come into this lifetime. So taking the journey of incarnation. And you're chatting with God in the cafe upstairs before you come down here, and God says, well, what about learning a bit of this, and what about learning a bit of that? You need these things for the soul's journey. So at some point, whether it's this incarnation or another one, you've got to learn to deal with it. And over the years, there are so many things that I've had to learn how to do. That I never would have imagined in an ordinary life. You know, if I go back into my ordinary awakening, there's no way any of these things ever would have come down this particular path. But at some point, someone chose to awaken me or start the awakening process. And ever since then, it's like almost every day there's a new lesson coming up. And there's never time for any boredom. So, moving forward in life, coming back to that theme, I think what you've got to do is you get up every day with hope in your heart. And, of course, it's very easy to get knocked down by the sticks and stones that come to beat us in life. You know, everyday life can be a tough process.
It can.
And, a very tough process. And, you know, you've not been without the tough times, Alan, in your life. And I think most of us that are on the spiritual path at anywhere near a kind of elevated stage very soon learn that they're all the time absolutely in that place of trust. And I learned many years ago to, you know, just forget trying to own a house anymore because they took it off me twice. Just give up. Stop it. They're taking it away. and what they were teaching me was you have to learn to totally trust that, you know, there will be food on the table, and that's all that matters at the end of the day.
It is, actually, isn't it? It is.
Yeah. You know what? Humanity, all of humanity, only wants a few basic things. They want light. They want heat to keep them warm. They want food in the belly, and they want to be loved. And the most important is that sharing of the love. All humanity is the same. And I get quite wound up sometimes when I see one group going into war against another group. Because if you take all the politics out of it and the idealism out of it, all they all want is the same thing, which is a bit of light, a bit of heat, something in the stomach, and someone to love them.
Yeah.
And funny old world, isn't it?
It is. Considering, you know, millions of people over the planet, over time, have perished. And when you actually think about it, what for? For nothing, really.
Yeah, that's right.
So, with the Emerald Heart, do you see it's the more people who can connect with it, understand it, understand that what you're actually doing is connecting really with yourself and with the God source to show that we're all really on the correct path. It's just that we kind of get lost in the fog.
Yeah, I lost you there, Alan.
I'm sorry, yeah.
We get lost where?
Yeah, I mean, it's like we're all of us start out on the right path, but we get lost in the fog.
Yeah, absolutely. So, it's just an interesting process. This is what the guidance taught me as I was working, before I even had the Emerald Heart Light, actually, is when I was working with some different frequencies of light, the ones that really burned me open. And this is what they taught me about humanity. The first 20 years is about learning to be a child in the earth plane. And what they mean by that is about don't rush things, learn how to play for the first 20 years. The second 20 years is about learning how to be an adult in the earth plane. So this brings you up to around about 40 years of age. Yeah. And what they showed me was between the age of about 38 and 42 is the awakening period. So this is a time that a lot of people reference to midlife crisis, if you like. Mm-hmm. And making me laugh now. The guys are just reminding me of when I had a red sports car around about that age. And all my mates were saying midlife crisis. Well, do you know what? I've still got a red sports car. I'm 62 now. So the crisis has been going on for a few years. So at this age between 38 to 42, this is kind of the door opener where God is saying, okay, well, you've had your playtime. You've been the child. You've learned what life's all about as an adult. You might have your career now, etc., etc. But of course, at that age, what most people have done is they've locked themselves totally into patterns. They've locked themselves into maybe families and mortgages and jobs they can't afford to lose. They've quite often become prisoners of the circumstances that they've created. And so when the awakening pressure comes, they find it very difficult to let go of what they already had. You know, this happened to me on my own journey. Yeah. So when I was, about 38 to 40, this is when my awakening started. You know, I had wife, family, mortgage, all those same things, small business, a couple of small businesses in actual fact. And the universe smashed the lot. Now, for some people, you kind of get a little bit of a break. But for other people like me, you don't get that break at all because the universe is awakening you for a specific mission. And it's kind of saying, okay, well, you've had your time on Earth. Now you're working for us. You know, it's like the mafia, really, isn't it?
I suppose it is.
There's no way out. There's no choice. No.
Yeah. As long as I don't wake up one morning with a horse's head beside me.
Horse's head sandwich.
That's it.
Well, you know what it's like because we've walked similar paths, haven't we?
Yes, very much so.
And I remember you telling me that story about, you know, when you were doing the dart flight thing.
Oh, right, yes.
You took all your business stuff down the tip and you threw it into a skip because you knew you couldn't do it anymore.
That's right, exactly. And, you know, it wasn't even the case of selling it on to somebody else. I mean, it was like the only way I'm going to get rid of this is just literally let it go. And that's exactly what I did. And, and I never actually regretted it for a moment. It was like, well, that was meant. It didn't mean that everything was wonderful afterwards. I carried on struggling, but there's no turning back then, no turning back.
Yeah. And you kind of wonder where the struggle comes from. It's us that create the struggle. There's no doubt about it. You know, I had a period of months last year where there was amazing struggle going on, and I just stopped one day and I thought, well, it's you that's doing the struggling, Dave. The universe isn't struggling. You just have to sit tight. And at some point, they'll turn things around for you.
Yes.
And, you know, I was going through deep inner transformation, and the universe was basically saying, well, you can't work while you're going through this, Dave, so put your feet up. But because we're human and we go into that, how am I going to pay the rent this week kind of thing?
Yeah.
Because the only way we do it is when the universe sends us some clients. And I remember... Many years ago now, it must be about 12 years ago, I should think. Might be a bit longer than that, 13 or 14, in fact. In fact, I tell you, Alan, it was 13 years ago, because it was at the time we were just losing touch with each other, and you'd made a call to me, and I returned it a couple of times, and we never connected, and that was the start of our 13-year hiatus.
Yes, that's right.
And you see, Go on. Yeah, so at that particular time, I used to get guidance in odd places. And one of the times and places I got guidance was if there was anything to come, it would be given to me as I swung out of bed in the morning and my feet touched the floor. The moment they touched the floor, that's when the guidance would be given to me. And it was funny, there was a whole series of patterns like this about when guidance would be given. And one such place was on the third step from the bottom of the steps as I was coming downstairs. And I was coming downstairs this one day, and all of a sudden I was given this vision for the front cover of a book. And I just went into the front room and I drew it out. Are you still with me?
I am, yeah, I'm listening intently.
All right.
Yeah.
Blimey, the line's so good, I thought you'd gone. But I've forgotten the point I was going to make.
Well,
I remember. It's come back to me. Right. And I put my feet on the floor this one morning, and the guidance said, you will never need to worry about money again. Now, you know, as I say, 13 years ago that was. But what happens is, the guidance is saying you will never need money again. But because we're patterned as humans, you find yourself worrying about money when you haven't got any.
Yeah.
Instead of going into the, okay, there's no money coming in at the moment, what does the universe want me to do something else? So it usually takes me sometimes either a couple of weeks when that happens to figure out and say and remind myself, oh, you don't need to worry about money, Dave, because it's going to come some way or other when you need it. And it always, always does.
Yeah, it does. That's very true, that is.
So how can we bring that back into our theme of moving forward in life?
Well, you see, the hardest thing, Dave, I think is what you've hit upon there, is to trust that if we are doing things for the right reasons, we will be looked after. We will be, I wouldn't say the word given, but what we need will be provided as long as we can understand what that is what we need. Because lots of time it's what we want, not what we need, that we seem to go for.
Yeah.
Uh, I, I think we're literally on time for a break, Dave. So if we have a break now, I'm sorry, it's right. It's Dave saying, no, another 2 minutes because you started late.
Do not any jokes.
No. See, these are the secrets, folks, all right, behind the scenes. Dave, the producer, likes everything to be done and said without any of you knowing, and I blurt it out and tell you what's going on. Oh, dear me.
Do you remember the magic roundabout?
Yes, I do, yes.
Do you remember Zebedee, the character with the spring sticking out of his backside? Poor lad.
Yes, I do.
Well, every now and again, I get this boing noise and you go offline. So I've got this vision of you bouncing on a spring all over the living room.
It's 11:30 at night. I haven't got that energy, Dave. And Dave needs to write why I said 3 minutes. Last night he wrote 1.5 minutes and then he put half. And I said, "All right, okay, I've got to get off now." And then he said to me when we finished, "No, I meant 1.5. I thought I'd written 12. I think we're all on something at the moment. I don't know what it is.
Well, it's not sunshine, that's for sure.
No, that's true. Have we waffled long enough, Dave, so we can have a break?
Right, here's the biscuits. I'm getting the biscuits out.
Yeah, okay. Well, we'll go to break now. He says, well, whatever, go to a break. We'll see you after the break, folks. Don't get anywhere. Hello, welcome back to The Emerald Art. I'm Alan Cox, one of your hosts. Dave Ashworth is my partner in crime this evening. And if you want to know more about myself, then look me up at www.calmingthoughts.com. That's calmingthoughts.com. And you, Dave, the best way for people to know about you is...
The best way for us is on our blog at emeraldheartlight.com, or you can even look at the website, which is emeraldheart.co.uk. So that's emeraldheartlight.com for the blog and emeraldheart.co.uk for the website. And at the moment, there's a little bit of activity on the blog because we're in Lanzarote for our winter retreat, which begins on Monday. People have started arriving today, and I've been here 4 weeks with Harriet, who's organising the event for the Emerald Heart. And we've had 4 weeks of almost fabulous sunshine, and in the last couple of days since people started arriving, the weather has turned terrible.
Well, if they've come from the UK, they've bought it with them.
Well, actually, there's a couple of people, a couple of friends. Lynn Shaw, one of our elders, and her husband have come from New York, and I think they've left minus 26 degrees behind, so they think it's great anyway.
Oh, dear me. Yeah. They're a hardy lot, our American friends are, aren't they? They certainly are, just lately.
They've had some interesting things that the universe has been throwing at them.
Certainly, indeed. I mean, really, you know, I mean, it's been pretty horrendous in parts of the UK for it actually to get to the news in America. It doesn't normally, but looking at what's been going on over in America with the snow and the cold and that, it's talk about an Arctic blast.
Yeah, yeah. So, on Monday we start our retreat out here. So we've got, it's been very interesting as always, because although it's nice to have a plan for these things, they rarely go according to plan, because the moment you start, the guidance has a different plan. But it's good to... If you're going to do a week's work with some people, and we've got a fair old group coming over, it's good to have an idea that you won't be sitting there twiddling your thumbs wondering what to do.
Yes.
And just today, actually, I sat down to write a couple of words in the plan, and I was knocked completely unconscious, and I came round, and it was like I'd just had an operation on the brain. I thought, oh, well, here it is. This is the start. At last, they're going to start putting something together for me to say. So I started to feel a little bit better this afternoon that we would actually have some kind of a plan come Monday when we start, and it's only a couple of days away. We've only got Saturday and Sunday, and then we're launching into the retreat. And Lanzarote is a great place because it's volcanic. The most recent volcanic action was 1824, and there's still some pretty hot stuff just under the gate here. So yeah. We've got all the elements of earth, wind, and fire to name but one band.
Yes.
But you know, we've got the powerful sun, we've got the sea, we've got the wind, we've got the earth is amazing here. I've been driving through the lava fields this week and just getting connected with the spirit of the landscape, and it's going to be a great time. And hopefully the weather's going to pick up on Monday. I hope so, because I've got 3 half days where we're going off into the landscape to do some work into some stunning places. So I'm really looking forward to what spirit brings through in those places. It never lets us down, so it's going to be great fun.
You see, that's the thing, isn't it? Everybody coming there have got their own perception of what it's going to be like. There might be some who come in totally with an open mind and not thinking of anything, but most people have a thought pattern of what they think it's going to bring to them. And spirit always has its way of surprising people.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I never cease to be amazed at the stuff that goes through. And the nature of our retreats have changed in the last couple of years. And we always used to do a week-long event down in South Wales at a place called Buckland Hall, a stunning place, off the beaten track a little bit. Fabulous trees in old gardens. You know, you could really get connected into the nature spirit consciousness there. And we would do a themed week. There's always some kind of theme that the guidance is bringing through. And in this particular retreat, we've got 4 separate themes, and in fact, an overall theme as well. So I'm trying to work 5 themes, which takes a bit of juggling, I can tell you.
Yes.
And I've been scribbling notes down today, and it's just starting to make sense in how these themes come together. And what I've found is, I may have even mentioned this before, that each retreat we did just got better and better, more and more powerful, more deep seeking into the consciousness of the people. And it reached a point where you thought, it just can't get any better. It's not possible to have a better event than this. Everything was just so coherent and everybody was so much on the same wavelength. And each one, they break that paradigm and bring something new that just leaves everybody on this absolute. I mean, we had the last retreat in Sweden only in August. And so I've done this winter retreat, really. It's a bit of a last-minute thing. We've offered it out literally at cost price, just so it gives people an opportunity to start the year off very quickly with the energy and the power of the sun, because the nature of this coming year is going to be expansion. Now, there's 2 different ways you can look at this. The everyday world of collective consciousness will see a year of chaos this year. There's no doubt about it, because, you know, apple carts are going to be upturned. But in the process of upturning apple carts, there are many, many opportunities that the universe brings forth. It doesn't take something away and not offer you something new. So, you know, when we give out where the guidance gives me what we call the guidance for the period, usually every 6 weeks, it takes me into the universe, shows me the pattern, says, this is what's coming, Dave. This is how your people can prepare for it. And you might remember a couple of shows ago, Alan, you got the theme. We had to talk about the spring equinox when we were actually in the middle of the winter solstice.
That's right.
And what the guidance gave me at that point was, rather than giving me a period of 6 weeks, it gave me this period of 3 months that led right up to the spring equinox. And it said this whole period is about expansion. Do as much as you can do now, because this will sow the seeds for the rest of the year. And it's like, you won't have to struggle to get things to move. If you do it now, it'll just move, because it'll be riding that wave of universal time.
Can you hear me, Dave?
Yeah, you've come back now.
Okay.
Boing.
Yes, okay. You're on about the the different seasons, and I bet you haven't thought about this one, and I don't know whether there's any significance to it, but your birthday is in October.
November.
Okay, so you're just coming out of autumn into winter.
Yeah.
And mine is at the end of March, so I'm coming out of winter into spring. And it's like both our birthdays are literally on the cusp of two different seasons.
That's right, yeah.
And I suppose we're both born at those times. Perhaps it's because our lives were always meant to be changing, you know, the changing energies. I don't know, but perhaps I'm talking out the top of my head, but it just came to me and thought, well, yeah, there's some kind of significance there. It's
the way we'll get on at all.
Well, I used to be married to a Scorpio, and a birthday is, because you're still around, is the 31st of October, Halloween. So I can actually say I've married a witch, can't I?
Well, you can't.
Yeah. Now, she's the mother of my children, and quite seriously, for that, I do love her. So. Mm-hmm.
Right. So, well, Aries is an interesting sign, isn't it? Because it's the first sign on the astrological wheel. So it's interesting that you've chosen to come here as an Aries this time. Because quite clearly, you've done a lot of work in past lives to be working at the level you're working in this lifetime. So it's like God has said to you, all right, Alan, well, you've done some amazing things. You've worked through a lot of lessons in a lot of different signs, but you've just got to pop back to the beginning because you've missed a couple here. So I kind of see that looking into your sign as we're talking right now. It's like, yeah, well, you've done all this amazing work, so we're going to bring you up to speed as fast as we can. But you've got to just touch back into that Aries stuff right at the beginning, because Aries is like being the first sign on the wheel of incarnation. That's the baby sign. These are the babies. You quite often find, let's say there are Aries that come early. There are early Aries. They're learning the first lessons. And there's the middle-aged Arians. And they're learning the middle-aged lessons. And then there's the late Aries. Well, you're a late Aries because you've already been playing with the power of things like Scorpio and Pisces before. So Pisces is very, very deep water, and Scorpio is quite deep water as well. And so the water signs can take you into very deep places where you can learn how to play with power. And so you've had those power signs before in some quite considerable measure. And it's like, oh, well, here you are, back at square one on the snakes and ladders board.
Right, okay.
You know, just take your time, walk through life at an easy pace, but keep just looking at the lessons you're trying to learn, because you've missed a couple of things out as you've been passing through. So we might have to have a look at that one of these days.
Okay. Yep. Yep.
Well, there you go. You didn't know you were going to get an analysis tonight, did you?
Well, no, but it makes sense. I mean, I'm typical to what people class as Aries, is that I can be, how can I put it? I always think I'm right. I don't mean that in an ego way, but I just convince myself I'm right. And it's, but they say that I'm, that the sign, you know, Aries are very kind of faithful. And I would say, yeah.
Sorry, say that bit again, Alan. I lost you.
That's how the Aries people are very faithful, and they make a friend. And to them, the person is a friend. And that, yeah. I must admit, I am like that, you know. But sometimes I can be my own worst enemy. Get myself into situations. Through not thinking things through, I suppose, sometimes. And yeah. I think it's probably very relevant talking about it, because this is about the journey of going forward, is like what we were talking about at the beginning of the show.
That's right, yeah. And, you know, I don't like to kind of look at certain aspects as negative aspects, as in negative meaning bad. But, yeah. You know, we come into life and we do have positive aspects to our personality that are very helpful. And we do have aspects of the personality which are not quite as helpful. And those are most definitely lessons to learn. And being a Scorpio, one of the Scorpio lessons is to get through the self-destructive mode. Scorpions are very self-destructive. And they often do it in dramatic ways, like in excessive ways, like through drink or drugs, etc., etc.
I must admit, from my experience with Scorpio, being married to a Scorpio, my ex-wife is exactly like that. And she goes through, even now, kind of traumatic times. So, yeah, I understand where you're coming from.
Yeah. Those are the things we need to bring into our consciousness so that we can begin to overcome them. So, you know, reading some good astrology books, Linda Goodman comes to mind immediately, who's not with us any longer, but she was an amazing astrologer. And I learned so much in the early parts of my path through reading her books. And if you can pull in or focus on the on those aspects of the personality which are maybe not so wholesome but are also the lessons that you're here to learn, then you're immediately starting to move forward through life.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I can never tell whether you're still with me and I'm waiting for you to say something or we've lost contact.
I know. We'll have to develop intuition, Alan, so we know what's going on.
We'll have to own up our clairvoyant skills. That's what it is.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah. It's all down to the weather, I think.
Yeah. Well, we should be able to transcend Skype and broadcast just through mind thought.
Yeah. Action. And this is tying into one of the universal laws called the law of reflection. Basically, if you do nothing, nothing happens. So you have to trigger the law of reflection to make things happen. So one of the reasons we're having this retreat in January is that a lot of people go into a kind of semi-coma space after Christmas, and they don't wake up again until February. What I like to do is to get things moving with some very powerful energy in January. So last January we were in Munich teaching, so we started a teaching day early in the year. So come the middle of February, people are already working with those new energies that they've connected into. And it's the same with the retreat here, you know, third week in January. We're all going to get down in the sunshine and do some great work, working with light, working with energy, working with consciousness, and opening ourselves up. So by the time we get to mid-February, that light will be working so powerfully in those people that have been on the retreat that come March, April, May, and June, they'll be absolutely flying.
Yes. I must admit, I find this time of year, I'm always happy when I see that it's getting lighter a little bit earlier and staying lighter a little bit later. It kind of perks me up. Makes me, you know, makes me feel good. We've got about 2 minutes left, Dave. So, do you want to tell everybody? Sorry, go on.
I was just going to say, well, it was full moon last night. And just to remind people how the moon pulls on the emotions, I was just doing something in the house last night and suddenly realized how dry my hands were. And I thought, have I not drunk enough water today? And then I realized it was the moon pulling. Because just as the moon pulls the tides, it pulls the water in the body. And people will often find they've got very dry hands near coming up to a full moon and for maybe a week or so after. And so it's a good time just to keep feeding yourself some water for this next week or so. And just taking notice of the moon and the moon's energies and what they actually do to you. Just to remind the people, you can find us on the blog at emeraldheartlight.com. And Alan, do you want to give yours?
Yeah, mine is calmingthoughts.com. So Dave was saying what's wrong. He could hear us both fine, yet I was finding it hard to hear you. So anyway, as long as our listeners heard us, that's the main thing. So, but who knows what next week we'll be talking about? Yeah, now he's gone. Are we off air or on air? I'll say goodbye. Thank you very much indeed, everybody, for listening. And internet allowing, we'll see you next Friday, 6 p.m. Eastern time. So I'll say goodbye for both of us. So it's goodbye from me and it's goodbye from him. See you next week. Bye.